Hey, good evening, everybody. If everybody will start making their way in, we'll begin to start our worship services this fine, lovely Sunday afternoon. Let's go ahead and let's just begin to shift our minds into a place of worship. That's what we want to do this evening. We want to go into a place of worship. We want to get into an intimate setting with the Lord. So if you will, just stand with me and let's go to the Lord in prayer. And let's just begin again to make that shift into His presence. Yes, we have been thankful this week. We have given Him thanks for everything that He has done for us, everything He's provided for us. But now we're just going to go into a time of worship, a time of praise, and a time of intimacy with Him. Father, we love You and we bless You. And Lord, we just say now, God, Holy Spirit, just come into this place. Come in here that we may fellowship with You, that we may become one with You, that we may be in Your presence, and that we may offer up a praise that You can find to be a sweet aroma in Your nostrils, God. Let it be a sweet sound unto Your ear. So Holy Ghost, we just pray that Your presence would just come saturate this sanctuary and come saturate the hearts of each and every believer that's in this room tonight, God. Oh, let us go behind the veil. Let us go behind the veil and to just have that time of intimacy and worship with You. Let us break open that alabaster box and just pour out our heart to You, oh God. We just love You and we bless You. We glorify You. We magnify You. You are so beautiful. You are so, so good to us, Lord. And we just thank You for all that You do and just who You are. We love You, Jesus. Just worship the Lord tonight. Just get into that place. If you will, just come to the altar or just kneel where you are, but get to that place where it's just you and Jesus. It's just you and Jesus right now. We're behind the veil. Nobody else is around. Nobody else is watching. We're just in that place where it's just us. It's just me and Him. Nobody else is here. And just begin to worship Him tonight.
And feel the atmosphere. must become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. And Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. And Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. I'm caught up in your presence. I just wanna sing your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment, and I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you just want you. And I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up heart to you. And I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm caught up in your presence. I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy. And I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything. just gone through the motions. I'm sorry. I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. And I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I just want you, nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you, nothing else. Nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you. Nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you. Nothing else. Nothing else, nothing else will do. I'm caught up in your presence. I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy. Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you. I just want you. Nothing else. Nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you. Nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you. Nothing else. Nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you. Nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I'm caught up in your presence. I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment, and I never wanna leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you.
Let's just pray together before we step into the word. I know there's several that are just not feeling well. Josh is actually feeling better today, so thank you for your prayers for him. Better this afternoon, I should say. But there's several that we want to pray for. I know looking around the room, you see someone missing. Miss Andy, just even your head. How's your head feeling? Needing a touch? Yeah. If you will, if we could just take a moment and just as a church, let's go in on purpose. You know, faith is what moves God. Faith moves God. And so I just want us to intentionally go into a time of prayer in faith. And faith is just believing what God said is true. And that's just a little adjustment you can make in your heart. I want us to pray for those that are sick. I know little Miss Chloe, she had her eardrum that ruptured through the night, so she had to go to the emergency room today. Just several of our young people that are not feeling well. Can we just pray for all of them? Y'all with me? All right, let's go into prayer right now. Father, we thank you, first of all, of your word. Lord, what you said. You said that by your stripes that were put on you at crucifixion, by your stripes, Jesus, we were healed. And so, God, we just thank you for the healing that comes from the atonement, the healing by the blood of Jesus, the precious drops of Jesus that were poured out. And, God, you did that for us. Now, God, in faith, we just reach out and we grab what belongs to our family, what belongs to the children of God. Lord, we thank you for health in all of their flesh. Lord, that the same spirit that raised you from the dead quickens mortal bodies tonight in Jesus' name. And we just say right now, those of you at home watching, we call the peace and the life of God to your body, to your mind, to your soul. Lord, every grieving heart tonight in this community, those that have lost children this week, those that have lost daughters, Lord, this week, we just pray the peace that doesn't make any sense to go into those homes. Lord, we thank you, Father, that you take what Satan meant for evil and you turn it. God, you're the only one that could possibly do that. Turn it. Lord, bring comfort and peace to those hearts in Jesus' mighty name, in Jesus' name. And now, Lord, prepare our hearts, God. We just ask for divine utterance tonight. We thank you, God, that you prepare our hearts to receive, our hearts to hear. Lord, we want to hear you. You said your sheep know your voice. And God, we just tune our ears in to hear what you're saying. We say, speak, Lord, your servant's listening. We endeavor to hear you tonight and be changed by it. We give you glory. We give you thanks, Lord. Receive glory tonight. Receive glory. Lord, receive glory. Just take a moment and just worship him in your own words. Jesus, receive the glory tonight. Lord, we thank you that you are seated at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for us. Lord, I thank you that you've prayed for us tonight, that you are praying for us tonight. Lord, that whatever we're going through, I thank you, Jesus, you have answers. You have solutions. You have grace. You have strength. And so, God, we just receive that. We drink it up tonight in Jesus' name. And all the saints said, amen, amen, amen. Why don't y'all take just a minute before you sit down and get cozy and comfortable and just greet a few people, wish them a Merry Christmas. Now, we can wish each other Merry Christmas now, right? It's official. Ask them how many days they eat their turkey leftovers. Is it 2 days? 3 days? On the third day, the turkey rises.
No. Why do you never get my...
Thank you. Thank you, Miss Leanne, for give her a hand clap, just playing that baby grand. So sweet. So glad it can get some good use up there. Thank you for leading us in worship tonight. It's just cozy, y'all, tonight. I like being together with our church family. You know, growing up, I know Sunday nights are hard sometimes to come back. Did anybody get their nap in today? I got a nap. And sometimes when you pass out, you don't want to get back up. You need that resurrection power to get you moving. But I will say this, growing up, my church up in Minnesota, we always had Sunday night services. And I'm telling you, that's where the best things just seem to happen. I mean, so I'm thankful that you're here tonight. I pray that you're here intentionally. And if you just kind of came out of habit, it's okay to make just that little heart adjustment and just say, Lord, don't let this be worthless. Let this be worthwhile coming tonight. Something so precious about gathering with our saints and our brothers and sisters. And I hope y'all don't mind. I don't know if you mind or not. I didn't ask your opinion on it, but we have had, maybe Pastor Sean, we could get that stand just in case. I just thought of that. Past several weeks, we've just had some powerful women of God that are raising up in this church, and they've been sharing, and there's been just such a huge amount that we've just let them. Do you guys mind that? Is that okay that we just let them finish out tonight sharing? I want to say this about it, that there's something about this New Testament model of the way the New Testament did church and then the way America does church. Sometimes you see discrepancies, right, Brother Virgil? Am I telling the truth? Okay. I remember during the COVID year when everything got shut down, I had been going through the book by Francis Chan called Letters to the Church. It's a great book, great book. And it was talking about, you know, if you had to, all the reasons that people in modern day times go to attend a church service. So all the reasons you would have maybe on a checklist of in a church, I'm church hunting, this is the kind of church I want. How many of those things really line up scripturally or biblically with what the New Testament model was? And y'all, that was very humbling because I'm thinking, you know, you want a great kids program, and there's nothing wrong with any of those things. But at the very, very heart of what Jesus birthed, the church that he is the head of and we are the body of, it's saints coming together and being together to strengthen one another, to pray, to take communion, to teach the word of God, and to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. And I'm telling you, we have ministered just sprinkled all throughout this church. This morning, next time it happens, I just happened to be the person closest to Josh. So he said, he tagged me in, which he is feeling better this afternoon. So thank you for your prayers. But I'm telling you, we could pass this microphone to so many of you in the room. I'm just so excited about what God is raising up. I mean, what in the world is he getting ready to do with you? It's amazing. It's amazing. And you know, we are all connected to the same vine, right? Like my connection to the vine, Pastor Josh is connected to the vine. It's not any better than your connection to the vine, right? Like you can draw up the same nourishment from the same root. And so I believe that we see that happening. And so I just want a few more of our ladies to share because God's raising up some powerhouses. I want this one to come up. I'm so, y'all just love this girl so much. I'm so proud of you, too. You have such an amazing story, what God is doing. And Diana, she got to come with us to the retreat, okay? And I'm just so thankful for you. And I remember, Diana, I don't know if you remember this, like, it's back when we had Tuesday morning prayer times. Do you remember this? And I just remember the Lord laying you on my heart so strongly and just, like, God's plans for you were just so explosive in my mind. And I don't think you were coming at that time. But anyway, to be able to see like how God is just pushing you forward and leading you. And I'm so excited for you to share. So you just tell us what God's doing.
Hello. It's not a lot of the times that I get to leave my home and my children, but I did get to leave them and go. So I just don't really know how to start this. I'm just going to go into what I wrote down here. One thing that is literally the first thing I wrote on my paper was from Judy Jacobs, and she said that expectation is the breeding ground for miracles. That's like that sweatshirt we all have that's like, it's not if, but when. So it's not, God, are you going to do this? It's no, God, when are you going to do this? So I think it's hard to get up and do these things because we get pushed down by the enemy right after we do it. The enemy's only after you because you're strong. I fully expect him to do something to me after tonight because it always happens. Something happens. What Kim Jones said, which was kind of funny, but it's really powerful, was when you were born, the doctor heard crying. I'm not going to do what she did because I'm not that crazy, but when you were born, the doctor heard crying, but hell heard purpose. So, but the thing is when you're strong, Satan can't get to you. He goes after your children or your husband. And I don't know about y'all, but I'm not letting Satan touch my family. Thank you. Yes. Another thing is the church has gotten where Kaylee said you put God in a box. We don't like to be uncomfortable, but with God, you're always uncomfortable. It's kind of funny. That's what I tell Ivy all the time. I'll be like, babe, are you comfortable? He'll be like, yeah. And I'll be like, well, you're in the wrong spot because you're not supposed to be comfortable. But another thing is, it's hard to hear God when you already planned what he's supposed to say. And I'm going to go from that and go to the morning when we got back. I was in my prayer time, and I know for sure that I'm supposed to say this because God told me, so I'm just going to tell you. I was praying, and I was like, God, just speak to me. Like, it's hard for me to read this because I don't know where to start. So I just really felt Ezekiel, so I went to Ezekiel, and I just started reading. And in chapter 3, it says in verse 4, and he said to me, son of man, go to the house of Israel. And when I read house of Israel, I immediately heard the church. It says, and speak with my words to them, for you are not sent to a people of foreign speech and a hard language, but to the house of Israel, not to many peoples of foreign speech and a hard language, whose words you cannot understand. Surely if I sent you to such, they would listen to you. But the house of Israel will not be willing to listen to you, for they are not willing to listen to me. And that just broke my heart because God's supposed to lead us. So how are we, like, why do we put him in a box? We don't need to do that. If I can't pray the heavens down, there's a problem. Another thing is, this was day 2 with Kim Owens, and it says, she said, maybe your last encounter became religion. And we need to push through, push out of that, and really push into what God has for us. And then we started singing this song. I know where it's from now. It's called People Get Ready. But we were singing this part that was like, I can hear the rhythm of the Lion of the Tribe of Judah. And we just kept singing that over and over and over again. And the craziest thing happened. I closed my eyes, and then it's like a picture. So I guess like a vision. I saw a really big lion, okay? He had a crown on, and it was walking through my kitchen, going towards the room that we always sit in, which is my living room. And then I saw my front yard, and the lion was in my front yard, like he was just laying there, like my dogs do. It was like guarding my house. And then I saw him walking around my parents' house, because I've really been praying for them. But then I saw him walking. If you don't know, I work at a school in Irwin County. I saw him walking through the halls of Irwin County Middle School. So I'm just going to let you know, students, my girls over there, all my students in here, that revival's coming for you. So just get ready, because God's about to take you on a wild ride. The mantle of revival is about to be broken down. So we need to get ready. I'm going to stop there so they have more stuff to share. I don't know. That's all I had. I mean, I do, yeah, but.
She was just prophesying. She stepped over into just telling us something to prophecy. So I want you to receive this. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we receive that word, that revival, the reviving of the saints, the reviving of souls, the reviving of teenage hearts. Lord, we thank you, Father, that it's a supernatural thing. God, that it comes like a curse. It comes like a roaring lion, Lord, that his voice drowns out the voice of the stranger and the voice of the enemy. And God, we just thank you that suicidal thoughts are drowned in the voice of the roaring lion, that roar of love, that roar of protection, that roar of identity. We just thank you, God. We receive that for our teenagers. We receive it for every boy and girl in this county in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Thank you for sharing that. That's so good. Thank you. Thank you. Yes, ma'am. In Jesus' name. Lord, we thank you, Father, for the hedge of protection. And Lord, we just choose to believe that lion that is able to scare away the enemy. Lord, I thank you that though he comes to steal, kill, and destroy, you have come to bring life and to bring it in abundance. And so we just pray the abundant provision of the Lord over my sister. Lord, I thank you, Father, for health in all of their flesh, for setting a guard around them, Lord. And we just expect, Lord, that many may be the troubles of the righteous, but God, you deliver them up out of them all, that there is nothing that you can't deliver from. And so we bless her as she comes. We bless her as she goes. We bless her children as they go in and out of that house. We bless her husband as he goes to work and as he comes back. God, raise up that army and raise up that guard around him in Jesus' name. Angels of the Lord, in Jesus' name. Thank you. Thank you. That was good. All right. I know there's a couple other that wanted to share. Leanna, you want to come and share? You ready? Okay. I'm so thankful that we got to bring Miss Leanna with us, and I think she had a good time. She was on the TV more than anybody else, so I know they liked having her there. All right.
Thank you. I just have to say, you do not have to go to Wild Adventures to have an adventure. You don't have to get on a roller coaster to have an adrenaline rush. All you have to do is get in the car for 5+ hours with Dr. Shirley. And we're sworn to secrecy, so I will stop there. But no, speaking about the trip, it just seems like yesterday we just got back, and it was so good. I know that the people that I was with, that they could definitely say that we had so many encounters with the Lord, and even being able to watch everybody else that went on the trip that was from the church. It was just so amazing to watch how God moved on our lives. And then one thing that I really got from this was just how to truly worship the Lord. It's not about when you're worshiping, you know, that conviction of you're worshiping and you're singing one thing, but you're thinking in a whole other thing. That's not your heart. That's not the true heart's desire that God wants us to have for him. And that was something that God convicted me of, like, the first 2 days we were there. And then it was the last day that, like, you know, Kaylee spoke, and she really confirmed that conviction, not for it to be condemnation, but for that to just be confirmed that my heart was not in the worship standpoint where God wanted it to be. And that it's just being able to see his face, being able to realize who he is for us, being able to realize what he does for us, being able to realize that every breath that we take, it's not because it's voluntary. It's because it's involuntary, that God gave it to us freely. So something that I really got out of from, let's see who this was. This was Miss Kim Owens. I'm sure you have already heard a lot of us speak about the war cry, which a lot of us like got confused about what it was, war cry, raw cry. It doesn't matter. It's whatever your heart desired it to be. But it was war cry. And just to be able to be in a room with over 1,500 women, being able to, and she pushed us, like she really pushed us to find that. But it wasn't because of her glory. It wasn't because she wanted us to sound loud. It was because that when 1,500 women got in a room and found that war cry, it was a really loud voice against the enemy. And he had to flee. He had to get up and run because he was scared of who we were becoming and what the Lord was doing through us in this conference. And so something that she said was relationship with God is in pursuit of him, not our own selfish desires. It's not all about, Lord, I pray that you would give me this, Lord. God, I pray that you would heal me in this standpoint. All those things are good, but that's not the first place our hearts should be. It should be towards him and giving him thanks. And then another thing was that when Miss Judy Jacobs spoke, she said, when the battle gets ugly, we have to get uglier. And that really hit home because of just, you know, our whole lives. You know, every single one of us have a story where the enemy has tried to attack us, where he's tried to bring us down, where he's tried to shoot his arrows at us and just make us fall flat on our face. And sometimes we have, but by the grace of God, he helped us get up. But that really, she really taught us how to pray until, like she said, that our sweatshirt says it's not if, but when. How to pray until your victory comes, how to pray until that battle is won, that God does it for you. It's not because of ourselves, it's because of the Lord. And so something that she shared was in Luke 18:1. It said, one day Jesus told his disciples a story to show that they should always pray and never give up. And so I believe that was another conviction on my heart. You know, I really thought that going to this Pursuit Conference that it was going to be a filling up service, which it was, but it was also a reconstruction service for myself, and it was so good to be reconstructed. It's not always bad to be convicted. It's not always a bad thing to want to move your heart to a different place. It's not a bad thing at all because we should always want to change. We should always want to allow God to show us things that he could even make better so that we can be a better us for him. And so whenever it said to pray and never give up, it really taught me that, you know, you think about the times that you've prayed before and that you've prayed about something, and it just seems like it never comes. It never comes. You never get what you're looking for. So that's just like in the back of your prayer list to pray for, and then you eventually forget about it. But her saying that scripture to us really taught me that when you pray, it's to be fervent, and it's to never give up on that. And then, let's see. From coming out of each service, I just felt, even time we would walk out of the services, I would just feel so different. And like I told Lord, that just, it kind of feels like arrogance. I don't want it to feel like what it's feeling. And he told me, no, it's not arrogance. I'm giving you something that you didn't have before you come in here. And it was confidence. And so do not let the enemy tell you that you are little. Don't let the enemy tell you that you are smaller than him, because he may look big, but you are so much bigger because of who's on the inside of you. And so he was telling me that it's not arrogance, it's confidence, it's Godfidence. It's just something that he's trying to instill into us, and that he wants to do it the right way. We just have to allow him to do that. And then I just know that the enemy is coming for us. He's definitely coming for this generation, because he does not want us to be able to step into God's kingdom and do the things for him that pleases him. And so I just know that we have to pray until that. And then I was going into this conference also looking for something, but I felt like Miss Leanne did feel like, I don't know, Lord, if you are always speaking to me. I feel like sometimes I miss it. I feel like sometimes it's like a wall, because obviously I feel like I've built the wall up where it's hard for me to get to you. It's hard for me to reach you. But I wasn't going to share it because I felt like it was a little weird. But I felt like it's for someone to hear, because if God can speak to you through a bathroom toilet, he can speak to you through anything, and he can get to you however he needs to get to you. And the last day we were there, I was just asking the Lord that whatever God that you see fit that you do not want here, God, just take it away, Lord. God, that I give it to you, Lord. It's not mine to bear. It's yours. You told us in your word to give it to you and to cast it on you, cast our cares onto you, because you cared that much about us. And so I remember whenever I was getting ready to walk out of the restroom. Y'all, when you flush a toilet, it only takes, 10 seconds for it to flush, and then the water fills back up. No, whenever we left this, I was leaving the conference bathroom, the toilet took, literally, and I even recorded it, but I'm not going to show that, but it was just water, don't worry, because I did it again, but it literally took 40 plus seconds for this water just to flush. It just kept flushing. And I felt like the Lord was telling me all those things that you desired for me to take out of you or to flush out of you, I promise you, that's exactly what I'm doing. So I had a revelation in the restroom. But God is just working. He's working through our church, and he's working through all of our ladies. And I was very, very excited and very, very blessed to be able to go with everyone that we went with.
Bathroom toilet revelation. Love it. I love you. Love you. I'm so proud of you too. Thank you for sharing that. I just get exhorted by hearing the revelations that other people get from God. So thank you guys for doing that. Ms. Raina, do you feel like sharing? You want to come up and share a little nugget with us? Got some gold nuggets for us? Okay, come on. So glad that you got to go with us.
Me too. Preach this one. I don't really know where to start, except I really thought I didn't need to go and I need to stay home. And the night before, I'm gonna dump everything first. The night before, Pastor Josh had come, and I don't even know what he said or what he prayed. I was just miserable. And honestly, before I left, I told my husband, I was like, well, if we're gonna stay together, I just think that God better do something miraculous this weekend. And by the last night that we were there, I told Miss Vicky, it's been great and I've had fun and gosh, they've been preaching their pants off, but I just don't feel like I've got what I've come here for. And I just felt broken and lost about it. But anyways, I think the next morning, maybe, they talked about mentorship. And just going back and remembering where God has brought me from before marriage, before becoming a mother and everything. And not everybody knows a lot of my testimony, but like Stacy and Thibaut do. And I grew up in a home where I guess people would profess to be Christians, but they didn't really live it. And kind of by 13, I would just live wherever I wanted to with whomever I wanted to. And I didn't really have a dad, and didn't want anything to do with men. I had no intentions on ever being married until I lived with Stacy and Thibaut. And I was like, oh, my gosh, marriage can be amazing, and not all men are dirtbags. And it was these women in the church that whenever I felt like I just can't do this, there was a mentor there at every step. If I was drinking or if I was doing drugs, they loved me unconditionally. I remember Miss Tanya calling me. She's like, are you coming to church tonight? I'm like, no, I'm already down to 40. I ain't doing anything. And she's like, well, we don't care. The only person that cares if you've been drinking is you and the devil. So just bring your little drunk self to church. And I would come, and I remember sitting in the back, and, you know, if you're drunk or you're high, you're kind of paranoid. And I remember Pastor Dow just preaching, and I'm like, he's looking at me. He knows exactly what I've been doing. But anyway, I'm trying not to get too far off topic. But anyways, and just seeing those ladies on the stage, and I don't know their testimonies. It was nothing like that. But that, I guess, Pastor Judy were mentors to each of you. And it just reminded me that I believe we're going to go through these things even in our marriage and even in everyday life, because there's going to be somebody that's going to come up behind us that we're going to share our testimony, and it's going to be so worth it. So worth it. On the last day, Pastor Jamie said something that kind of hurt my feelings. I'm sorry, I should have had it ready. Let me see. Well, one thing, he was talking about blessing your past, blessing this over here so you can receive what's in the next door. But somewhere he talked about basically wives, well, to me, that I'm searching for something for my husband that I can't get from him. I can only get from God. And because I'm expecting him to give that to me, he can't get from me what he needs from me. And I was like, okay, it's kind of messed up, but I can see that. And then he said, take the pants back off and put them back on your husband's. And it really hurt my feelings because I say, well, I wear the pants around my house. And I say it jokingly, but a lot of times, and Anobi can say, like, I lack that honor and respect for my husband, but it's never been taught. And so I learned that through all of you in the last several years, and I envy that, but it's a really hard thing. So I was like, well, I guess I got my word on the last day. So I wanted to strive to do better and look for what I need in God and in my relationship with him and be what Obi needs me to be for him. But when we come home the first night, I don't know if y'all noticed, we're all in Obi's truck and my van is still sitting there, not at the shop, and it just started. I was like, well, I see the van's still there. Did you call? Did you try to get somebody to come get the van? And it was like God just, like, gave me a whooping. I was like, shut my mouth. Just shut up. That's not your place. And from the moment we got back, like, it's just been hell. Like, attack after attack after attack. And you really just want to throw in the towel. But I'm reminded again that one day my girls may have trouble. And they're going to look for that endurance and want to know, where did that come from? And I can say that it came from Christ. Because, I mean, you can lean on other people, but it's only going to be so much. And the rest of it is going to come from just him. Because in our human nature, you kind of want to just tuck your tail and run. But the Holy Spirit brings peace when it don't seem like there can be peace. But I really wanted to say how important it is to be a mentor to someone within your church. Because when I got... When I came to Osceola, I was a mess. And I just thought, I'm crazy. Like my mom would say all the time, you're gay, you're going to hell. You're gay, you're going to hell. And you are an alcoholic just like your daddy. And I was like, well, I want to know Jesus, but I'm already defeated. I'm going to go to hell. Might as well have fun while I can. But when I came here, it was so different. Stacy would pray for me, and I left because I was like, well, if I don't get out of Fitzgerald, I'm going to be dead before I'm 21. Like, I can just see it. And I remember Stacy just begging me, like, please just don't go. Don't go, don't go. I was like, I have to. Like, I just have to get away from here. And she and Tebow made me a promise. Or Tebow said, I told my wife, if you get up there and you change your mind, we'll come and get you. I was like, yeah, okay. Well, the first night I was there, I was doing the same things that I had done here. I was drinking and doing drugs. And I didn't know, because used to I would drink until I just blacked out and I didn't remember anything. So I woke up the next day. I had, like, all these text messages and missed phone calls. And it was from Stacy and Tebow. They're like, we're 3 hours away. We're 2 hours away. We're 10 minutes away. And I was in a panic because I didn't really know what was going on. But Hunter was probably like three. And they drove in that one night. They got in their vehicle and they drove all the way to New York. And it just showed me that, you know, an example of what the Bible tells us, that he'll leave the 99 for that one. And if those people do it for just a girl that's a hot mess, then God will do exceedingly more than that. And no, even after that, even though I wanted to do good, I still felt lonely, and I still felt like living with all these white people, and they're so perfect, and they're so sweet, and I've always had these, like, bad headaches, and I'd lay on the couch, and Hunter would just come by in his sweet little voice, and he'd say, "Dear Lord, please touch Miss Raina's head. Amen." And then he would just go and run, and I'm like, that's what I want my kids to be like. That taught me that. And the unconditional love of the women in this church, that when we come back here, I know it's kind of bittersweet, but I'm home sweet home, and I love being here. I don't think, Osceola, you don't know how blessed you are to have amazing men and women that are pouring into your kids, pouring into you constantly. People say all the time how what an amazing job we're doing with our kids. I'm like, that has been the church. I learned from Stacy. I learned from people here in the church, and just that unconditional love. And I just think it's so important. Most of the time we see women in the altar. We see women worship. We see women leading. But we rarely see men doing that. And I think that's something that, to me, it breaks my heart, because I want to see my husband doing that. But I don't see anybody teaching him. I'm not saying that you don't, but, like, if we both come from homes that you didn't get that. People would profess to be Christ-like, but they were not Christ-like. So to me, I'm like, how come it's such a struggle for this person, but it's not for me? But I had all these spiritual mamas. Women are different. So they just come in and they throw their hand around you and they just love on you. And men are like, why is he looking at me? It's just so different. So I just wanted to say, coming away from that, one, I learned to take the pants off and put them back on my husband. But don't ask OB if I've done that yet. And two, that we need mentors. And men need mentors just as much as us women do.
I remember Pastor Josh talking about how when you have that heart that's seeking and desiring, and when you have a heart, a contrite spirit that says, Lord, if there be anything within me that offends you, that is a scary prayer to pray. If there's anything within me that, because God does not mind pointing that out. He's a gentleman about it, but you do often see, and maybe this is what you were getting at, you do often see if you're going to pray that prayer boldly. And y'all, it's true. If there's anything within me that's hindering me from going forward in my walk with him, I want it out. But sometimes that is a painful cutting operation, the cutting of flesh, those desires that you have. But you know what? I do know this. I at least know this, that his way is the best way. So sometimes you do see those things come to surface. You know, after encounters with God, you see kind of the fire burns off of gold, the impurities, right? Is that how it works? I don't know how it works. I have no idea how this works. But the impurities, I assume they rise to the surface. Is that how it happens? And then you skim them off, and it creates an even purer vessel. And that's how I want to be. So it's not always pleasant or lovely, but we're all in transformation, right? Okay, there's one more, I think, that I want to let go. Miss Kendra, do you want to come and share with us a little bit? Is there anybody else that wants to, you just feel the unction of the Holy Ghost and you just want to let us have it? Yeah, I already talked to Nene about it. Oh, she's going to fight you. Okay, share with us what God did for you.
Okay. I wanted to say first before the little small thing I got, everybody got like one little thing. I got like one little thing, but I combined it. Kim Jones was talking about pray until something changes. Kim Owens, I just combined them all together. You pray until something changes. You pray until you get your breakthrough, your miracle, something, whatever you're praying for. And while you're praying, you got to get in that revival walk. That was Kim Owens. And Karen Wheaton said, you stay focused And all of this, you stand on your post and you do all of this, and the in-between that Jamie Tuttle was talking about, that's like the little thing I got. But Karen Wheaton was probably my big thing, because exactly what she said, I wasn't going to share nothing, or I was going to share the first night we got back, because God had gave me something, but he told me, that's for you. You just keep it to yourself. So the second night, we were sitting back there, and me and Justin was, and Leanne was up here. I don't know where she's at. And I leaned over to Justin. I was like, oh, my gosh, these people's got all these notes. Like, I don't have nothing. I wasn't going to share. And Shirley Bowles was like, you better share. And I was like, okay. And I had nothing. I had nothing that I was going to share. I didn't know what to say. I didn't know what to talk about. I was going through my notes like, okay, I got all these notes, but nothing's sticking out to me. Like, I don't know what. Like, oh, gosh, Lord. And I was sitting back there praying like, Lord, please don't let her call on me. Please don't let her call me, because I have no idea what I'm going to say. Leanne's got it all together. She's got all her notes. Like, look at her. Like, she's just awesome. And then Miss Grace gets up here, and she just brings the house down. And I'm literally thinking, Lord, please let Miss Grace keep talking. Please let her keep talking, because I do not want to go. I even got up and went to the bathroom so you wouldn't even see me and be like, come up here. I was hiding. And so all this week I was like, you got to find something, Kendra. But while I'm back there, what Kim Owens said and Karen Wheaton said kept playing in my mind, because I was having a battle in my mind. I wasn't having a battle. The devil and God was having a battle in my mind, because I kept hearing, you don't have nothing to say. You don't have nothing to tell these people. You don't have nothing. But everything that would come in my mind, God would throw something back out, and it would be something Karen Wheaton said. And Karen Wheaton said to stay focused. You got to stay focused, and you can't be like Martha. But it's good to be like Martha, because Martha was serving. She was serving, and it's good, but Martha got distracted. And I don't want to get distracted, and I let myself get distracted, because she said there's two voices that influence you the most, the shepherd and the stranger. And the stranger, you don't know the stranger. If some strange person come up to you, would you, hey, how you doing? There's my whole life story. No, you don't. And this is crazy that we were talking about this morning. I was sitting there. I don't know if you was noticed. I wasn't really paying attention. I was like, oh, my gosh, Lord, I hear you. Okay. So I heard the shepherd telling me, you hear what I'm saying. And when I heard that, John 10:27 come up in my mind, my sheep hear my voice and I know them and they follow me. And I was like, okay, Lord, I hear you. And I'm sitting back there like really hard, like very trying not to cry, because I'm like, I have nothing. I don't know what to say to these people. Like, I don't know. But we left, and I've been thinking about it, and it's like every little thing, just, I hear your voice, God. I hear your voice. I hear your voice. And I actually wrote down, and you was praying for Diana, because if you sit there and you listen to the stranger, he is like John 10:10. He's like a thief. He will come to kill, steal, and destroy. But a lot of people, they hear that, they see that, but they don't read the rest of the verse, what the rest of Jesus says. I have come, and I have come to give you life and life more abundantly. And it's almost like Martha, she got distracted. And it's something that Kim Owens said, that it's one thing to start a fire. It's another thing to keep it going. And I was thinking about that on the way here. I was like, okay, it's like God's the fire. And if you start, you got to keep that walk going, because if you get distracted being Martha, and it's not bad to be Martha, it's not bad to serve God, it's really not. I mean, you really need to do that, but you always want to be Mary. But if you get distracted and you look off, then that stranger's going to come, and he's going to try and kill. And there your fire is just going to die. You're not sitting there stoking your fire. You're not keeping it flamed up, and your fire will burn down. And then there you are hearing the stranger's voice and the stranger's voice, and then the shepherd's voice gets further and further away. So that was my thing. don't listen to that awful stranger's voice, because he does not know what he's talking about. He tells you lies. He tells you things that you don't need to believe. He tries to make you to believe things that are not true. And the whole time we've been in church, which is only a little over a year, that's one thing that I've had to learn, is not to listen to that stranger's voice, to listen to the shepherd. And I'm going to be the only one that cries. All week, that's all I've been hearing. I've had John 10:27 in my mind. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And you said it this morning, and I'm like, oh my gosh, okay, I hear you. I hear your voice, God. I really do. And I didn't get like a main thing. Like, I didn't have, like, everybody has something. But I was there to learn how to hear his voice, how to keep my fire going, how to stay focused. Because that's all I've seen is Karen Wheaton talk about staying focused, staying focused, staying focused. Don't be distracted. And I think I was letting myself get distracted with the job, our mess that we got at work, being a mama, being a wife. It can happen. Kids going to school, you get distracted. You get distracted, and you start listening to things that are not true. But we are children of God. He loves us, and he loves me. And what you said this morning, I've been telling myself, you love me, God. I am the one you love. I am the one you made, beautifully and wonderfully made.
Amen. Thank you. I'm God's favorite. Me. Y'all say that too? I'm God's favorite. Oh my goodness, he just loves me so much. I am the one that Jesus loves. I love that. She was referring to our Sunday school class this morning. We do our Bible quiz Sunday school classes for our elementary kids. And I gotta show you the video. I'll try to do it next week. But they learned the Lord's Prayer, and it was really sweet. We talked a lot about prayer. These stories that we heard leading up to the conference were all about the woman that just continued to, or the man that was knocking at the friend's door, and he's just persistent, and the woman going to the judge asking for justice, just persistently, just almost annoying. Here I am. I'm showing up. I'm not taking no for an answer. And so it was fun. It's fun teaching that to kids, and we've moved on. Today we were talking about Psalms 23, and we're talking about the Good Shepherd, the Good Shepherd. And y'all, I know it's just elementary kids, but I wish y'all could have been in the room for the revelation that was coming out of their mouth as they were talking about what a Good Shepherd is and who God is to them. It was so, so beautiful. So it's such a blessing to have them. And today we were talking about is my sheep, Jesus said, hear my voice. And no other voice do they follow. To me, this is just for me, I think the greatest thing about being able to walk with God is hearing his voice. When you hear the voice of God, to me, there is nothing better. It's saved my life. It saved my son's life to hear the word of God. And you can hear it. We talked about our heart that has ears to hear. You know, we physically hear people with this instrument that God made. But when God speaks to us, he speaks to our heart. It's as if our heart has ears. That's why he can talk. Sometimes it feels like a whisper. Sometimes it's so quiet. This is why, again, we should not be afraid of the solitude and just being alone to hear him. It's the greatest thing. And then sometimes we hear the word of God by reading it. And he spoke this word. We can read his word. Sometimes it's in a sermon or whatnot. But thank you guys so much for sharing all that tonight. I know the other ladies probably could, but we're just so thankful for letting us go. Glad to come back. Pastor Sean, you want to just exhort us for a second or two as we go out? Give us that 1-2 punch if these two, yeah. Whatever you want to do.
Thunder and lightning. Amen. Aren't you so proud of these ladies? Let's give them a hand clap of appreciation. Amen. I just want to encourage each and every one of you that you stood up here. You confirmed something for me tonight, every last one of you. Yes, Kendra, God does speak to you, and you do recognize his voice. You helped, along with Raina, along with Leanna, to confirm a message that God's given me. I was going to give a little snippet of it tonight, but no, I'm saving it. But that let me know that, you know, God is speaking to me as well. He's speaking to me as well, because he confirms his word by the mouth of 2 to 3 witnesses, right? So 1, 2, 3. There was 4 witnesses here tonight that confirmed what God's speaking to me. So, yes, ladies, y'all do hear the voice of God. And be encouraged. And I promise you, the brokenness that you are feeling, Raina, God's got a purpose for it. There's a purpose for it. And I'll let you know what that purpose is next week. And also, worship, Leanna. Again, it all ties in together. Every last one of you said something that just confirms what God was speaking to me. I'm going to go ahead and show you this real quick. Anybody know what this is? Well, it's not oil. It's just a container. But it's made of alabaster. This is an alabaster jar. It's made out of the same material that Mary, you talked about Martha and Mary. There's my confirmation right there. Poured out upon the feet of Jesus. But yet, just like this little vessel right here, it has a top on it. You could easily take the top off and pour it off. But the little flask or the jar that Mary had, it had to be broken. And in order for Mary to be able to pour out the oil that was inside of her, I'm going into it now, but in order for her to pour out the oil that was inside of her to give her worship to Jesus, it had to be broken. And Pastor Nadine said that we are vessels. So therefore, we're kind of like God's alabaster boxes, right? And there's something inside of each and every one of us, something unique. You see, the Bible says that what Mary poured out was spikenard. And the spikenard come from the Himalayan mountains in India. That's the only place it could be gotten from. It had to be imported into Israel. And so therefore, it was very costly, it was very expensive, and it was very valuable. And the amount that she had, Judas said that it could have been sold for 300 denarii. And that's basically a year's wage during that time. So think of it like today. Somebody had a bottle of oil, and they probably poured out maybe $30,000 to $40,000. And that's on the low end today of a yearly wage. So think about $30,000 to $40,000 worth of oil being poured out. It was broken upon Jesus as an act of worship. But here's the thing, though. Jesus wasn't worried about the cost of the oil. He wasn't worried about the value of the oil. It was what it cost Mary. Because not only was it just valuable to her monetarily, what she did and how she did it is what could have cost her. Because you got to understand the scenario. They were at a house. They were having a supper. They were having a feast. And it was customary to, during that time, to wash the guests' feet and then to anoint their hair, because it's very dry and dusty in Israel, and they would do that to kind of keep their scalp moisturized and their skin moisturized and their hair, and they would wash off their feet because it was just very dusty. See, they didn't do that at the beginning. It was done during the meal. And see, all eyes were on her. All the eyes were upon her, and she let down her hair after she poured out the oil upon Jesus. And for a woman to do that during biblical times, that pretty much insinuated that she was a woman of ill repute. It meant that she was a woman that didn't make some of the best choices, if you know what I mean. But she didn't care what everybody else was thinking. She didn't care about the criticism. She didn't care about the snarky remarks. She knew what she had to do, and she done it for her Jesus. She worshiped him. And even though it could have cost her her reputation, even though it could have cost her everything, she was willing to worship her Jesus and to pour it, to lay her livelihood on the line, not only financially, but her reputation. And that was a huge thing. Her honor as a woman, that was huge in that culture. She laid it all on the line as an act of worship to Jesus. Now, how much more should we be laying it all on the line for our Jesus? How much more should we be willing to pour out our oil? We're not worried about the criticisms. We're not worried about the smart remarks. We're not worried about everybody making fun of us. Because you know what? Judas made fun of Mary. He criticized her for pouring out that oil, which was about a year's wage. But the next day, scholars tell us, he went and betrayed Jesus for far much less. 30 pieces of silver was only worth maybe equivalent to $400 today. But Mary worshiped him with a value of $20,000 to $30,000, maybe even $40,000. So again, don't let somebody who's going to betray Jesus the next day dictate your worship. Don't let him dictate how are you going to pour yourself out. God is good, amen? But yet, we have to be broken. That brokenness, don't. It feels like the world is coming down. It feels like hell is coming against us. But there's something on the inside of you. There's something that God has placed inside of you. It's special, it's rare, and it's only in each and every one of us because God didn't call us to be anybody else. Because remember, that oil had to come from India. It had to come from the Himalayan mountains. It couldn't come from just anywhere. The anointing that God has placed inside of us, the oil that he has placed inside of us, yes, it comes from him. Yes, it comes only from him. But what he has given you is so special. It's so unique. Nobody else has it inside of them. So, yes, the Holy Spirit is speaking. He's talking. Let's just take a moment and let's just worship him for a few minutes. Let's just go out. We're going to receive the offering. And let's remember the announcements. Let's remember, you know, we have things going on, Christmas play. We have, the toy drive and everything. Let's remember all those things. But before we go, let's leave on a good note on it, because we started out worshiping. Go ahead, Hayden. Go ahead. And let's just leave loving him tonight. At the feet of Jesus. I'm so glad that Leanne chose that song. And it's in that line, and it says, I'm just sitting here at your feet. If you remember, Mary, who you brought up, Kendra, was at the feet of Jesus. There's three accounts where she was at the feet of Jesus. When she was sitting at his feet the first time, and Martha was so distracted, she was sitting at the feet of Jesus, taking in the words of life, taking in the truth. And then secondly, when Lazarus died, she first learned at the feet of Jesus. Then secondly, she surrendered at the feet of Jesus when she fell down and said, Lord, if you hadn't have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. But then it was at the feet of Jesus she got a revelation of who he was. And then thirdly, this account right here, she had true intimate worship at the feet of Jesus. So let's go out tonight before we leave. Let's sit at the feet of Jesus. And let's just have a moment. That's what it is. It's a holy moment. We are sitting here at the feet of Jesus. Let's just come. No pressures, no worries. Nobody else is around us. Pour out your alabaster box to him. Break open the box and pour it out upon him. Let's just sit here a moment and let's do that. Can we do that? Come to the altar. I'll move this. Let's just have those few moments of intimacy with our Jesus. And the thing about it, it's not going to cost us anything, really, not anything of monetary value. All it's going to do is just cost us our willingness to surrender to him and who he is. Father, in Jesus' name, we just love you and we bless you and we worship you this night. And Lord, we just pray that you would just draw us closer to you, Lord. Draw us closer to the feet of Jesus, because we know it's at the feet of Jesus where we receive eternal life. It's at the feet of Jesus where we are surrendered to the cross of Calvary. It's at the feet of Jesus where we can just have complete intimacy with you. And Lord, that's what we pray for as we come and as we bow down before you. We don't have any agendas. We don't have anything in mind. All we have is a desire to be in your presence, a desire to be closer to you, a desire just to know you in all of your glory. But God, we know it's going to come at a price. We know it's going to cost us. So God, let's do it. We worship you. We worship you. Let us go behind the veil and have that moment of intimacy. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, I'm not here for blessing.
I just want